our first lecture on numbers, we looked at natural numbers and integers. So now let's see what happens when we try to divide. So let's look at the rational numbers. So we said that we cannot represent 19 divided by 5 as an integer because we cannot find a number k such that 5 times k is 19. So as we know, the way we deal with this is to represent this quantity as a fraction. So we say that 19 divided by 5 is 3 and 4 fifths. So this number 3 and 4 fifths is an example of a rational number. So a rational number, what we usually call fractions in school, a rational number is something that can be written as p divided by q, where p and q are both integers. So as you probably remember from school, the number on the top is called the numerator. So p divided by q, p is called the numerator and q is called the denominator. So just like we had these symbols n and z to represent the natural numbers and the integers, we have a special symbol which is somewhat unusual, which is a q. So q stands for the rational numbers, and again, to just say it's a special q, we write these double lines on sides. So this q with these fat boundaries denotes the rational numbers. So one thing about the rational numbers is that the same number can be written in many different ways. Now this is not true of integers. Of course, we are not talking about changing base from binary to decimal or something. But if you write a 7, there is only one way to write 7 if you have fixed the notation that you are using for writing numbers. And with rational numbers, this is not true because there are many ways of writing p by q such that p by q is actually the same number. So for instance, if we take the number 3 by 5, then we all know that 3 by 5 is the same as 6 by 10 and it's the same as 30 by 50. So when we take a rational number and multiply it by something the same quantity on the top and the bottom, so 3 times 2 and 5 times 2, we get the same number, 6 by 10. Or 3 times 10 and 5 times 10, we get the same number, 30 by 50. So this is sometimes a nuisance, but it's also sometimes useful. Now, there is no reasonable way to compare two numbers like say 3 by 5 and 3 by 4 or 2 by 5 and 3 by 4. If we have two fractions which have different denominators, there is no way to directly compare them. So the only way to compare them is to somehow convert them into equivalent fractions such that they have the same denominator. So the usual way is just to find a number such that both the denominators multiply into that number or factors of that number. Now you can find the smallest such number, which is called the least common multiple, but you can find any number of this form. So for instance, if you want to add 3 by 5 and 3 by 4, now you can't do that directly, but you know that 20 is a number which divides, which is a multiple of both 5 and 4. So you can represent 3 by 5 as equivalently as 12 by 20. You can represent 3 by 4 equivalent. So this is equivalent and this is equivalent. So you have converted these numbers into a different fraction of the same number, but this new representation has the same denominator. And now once the two denominators are the same, you can add the numerators and you can get 12 plus 15 is 27 by 20. So this kind of manipulation requires the denominators to be the same, and therefore it's actually extremely useful that we can write the same rational number in many different ways. The same is true if we want to compare two numbers. If we want to check whether 3 by 5 is bigger or smaller than 3 by 4, there is no way to do it directly. What we have to do is again take the denominators and make them the same and then say that 12 by 20 is less than 15 by 20 because you are dividing something into 20 parts and you are taking 12 of them, that is less than taking 15. Now as I said, there is no reason why this must be the smallest one. So for instance, you could take a bigger number like 100, right? So 5 goes into 100. And 4 also goes into 100. So we could also say that 3 by 5 is the same as 60 by 100, and 3 by 4 is the same as 75 by 100, and therefore since 60 is less than 75, 60 by 100 is less than 75 by 100, and therefore 3 by 5 is less than 3 by 4. So it's not really important that the denominator is the smallest common multiple of the two denominators, but it must be some common multiple so that you can bring it all to a common number that you can then compare. So we saw that representation is not unique for rational numbers. So how do we find actually the best way to represent a rational number? So normally, if we are not using it for some arithmetic operation or for some comparison, we would prefer to have it in a reduced form. So the reduced form of a rational number is one where there are no common multiples between the common factors between the top and the bottom. So P by Q is of a form where we cannot find any factor F such that F divides P and F divides Q. So for instance, if we take 18 by 60, then its reduced form will be 3 by 10. Notice that 3 is of the form 3 times 1 and 10 is of the form 5 times 2 times 1. So therefore, there is no common factor between the top and the bottom, and therefore this is in reduced form. So this is called the greatest common divisor problem. So we want to find the largest number which divides both the top and the bottom, both the numerator and the denominator, divide them both by this and then come to something in the reduced form. So in this case, what we are saying is that the GCD of 18 and 60 is actually 6. And we can do this using our prime factorization that we talked about before. So if we look at prime factorization for 18, then 18 is 2 times 3 times 3, right? It's 2 times 3 is 6 times 3 is 18. And the prime factorization of 60 is 2 times 2 times 3 times 5. It's 4 into 3, 12 into 5. So now you can look at what are common. So we have 1, 2 here and 1, 2 here. So we can say that this is part of the same factor. We have 1, 3 here and another 3 there. The second 2 is not present in the first term. So we have a 2 and 3 in 18 which are factors. We have a 2 and 3 in 60 which are factors. And this gives us the fact that 6 is a common factor. There is no bigger common factor because if we want to assemble a bigger common factor, we have to pull out one more prime from each side, but there is no prime left which is present on both sides. 3 is there in 18, 2 and 5 are there on 60, but we don't have a matching one on the other side, right? So this way the common prime factors are 1, 2 and 1, 3. And so 2 times 3 equal to 6 is the GCD. Now, this is not the best way to find the GCD. There are more efficient ways to find the GCD, but this intuitively tells us what the GCD is. You take the prime factorization of both the numbers and you collect together all the primes that occur in both the numbers the same number of times. So here is another interesting property about rational numbers. Now, for each integer, we know intuitively that there is something which is the next integer and the previous integer. If I tell you 22 and ask you what is the next integer, then you will know it is 23. And what is the previous one? It will be 21. So for every integer m, the next one is m plus 1 and the previous one is m minus 1. And it doesn't matter if this is positive or negative. So for instance, if I am at 17, then the next integer is 18, the previous one is 16, right? If I am at minus 1, then the next integer is 0, and the previous integer is minus 2. So I can always take the integer that I am at, add 1 and get the next integer, subtract 1 and get the previous integer. So the property of this next and previous is that there is nothing in between, right? So there is no integer between m and m plus 1. There is no integer between m and n minus 1. So that's what next means. It's not some bigger integer or some smaller integer. It is the immediate neighbor in the integer of the, in this number line. Now, what about rationals? Is it possible to talk about the next and the previous rational number? Now, it turns out that this is not possible for a very simple reason. So between any two rationals, we can always find another one because we can always take the average of two numbers. So remember that if you take the average of any two numbers, then it must be between those two numbers, right? Because it is the sum of the numbers divided by 2. So the average cannot be smaller than both, nor can it be bigger than both. So if the two numbers are not the same, then it must lie strictly between them. If the numbers are the same, then the average is the same. So if somebody has 37 marks and 37 marks, then their average marks is 37. But if they have 37 marks and 52 marks, even without calculating the average, you know that their average is bigger than 37 but smaller than 52. Right? So in the same way, if I give you two fractions m by n and p by q, and I tell you that m by n is smaller than p by q. Remember that in order to do this, we would have to normally get the denominators to be the same and so on. But supposing I know that m by n is smaller than p by q. So I know that say m by n is here, and I know that say p by q is here. And supposing you claim that m by n and p by q are adjacent, that is p by q is the next rational after m by n. Well, I'll say no, let me take these two numbers and find its average. So this average now is also a rational number because you can also represent it as another p or a by b, right? If you just work out this m by n plus p by q divided by 2, you can simplify this whole expression and you will get a new number which is also of the form a by b. So this is also a rational number. And this rational number, as we argued, must be between the two numbers, and therefore between any two rational numbers, by just taking the average or the mean of the two numbers, I can find another one. So in other words, the rational numbers are dense, right? So dense in the usual sense. So dense just means that they are closely packed together. So basically you cannot find any gaps in the rational numbers, because between any two rational numbers, you will find another rational number. And this is not true of the integers, because we saw that in the number line, there is a gap between m and m plus 1. There is no integer there, right? So we say that the rational numbers are dense, and conversely, we say that the integers and the natural numbers are discrete. So a discrete set has this kind of next property, and a dense set has no next property. Between any two numbers, you will find another number. Right? To summarize, we use this funny symbol Q to denote the rational numbers. And a rational number is just a ratio. So that's where it comes from actually. So ratio, so a rational number comes from the word ratio. And so it's a ratio of two integers, P divided by Q. Now, there is no unique representation of a rational number, because we can multiply both the numerator and the denominator by the same quantity and get a new rational number which is exactly the same in terms of the quantity that it represents. And we use this fact for things like arithmetic and comparisons. But if we really want to talk about rational numbers in a canonical way, in a unique way, then we get this reduced form where we cancel out the common factors using prime factorization, so that we get a number whose GCD of the numerator and denominator is 1. And finally, we saw that we cannot talk about the next or the previous rational number, because between any two rational numbers, there is another rational number. In particular, if you take the average of the two numbers, you will find a number that is in between. So unlike the integers and the natural numbers, which are discrete, for which next and previous make sense, for the rational numbers, there is no such quantity.